here, we have two kinds of award for EMS. One is so-called EMS award standard, which is overall award, like I showed you just now, even in the smart. And I will show you that sometime later. And we have another specific award we call custom care award. And some of you here always qualifier for the custom care award, maybe for that. We've got several times and the whole year, almost every year. China used to, but now because you are using both system, so you lost the qualification. And Indonesia, maybe next one, Maldives got the award, right? And Mongolia, sometimes yes, sometimes no. And Vietnam, almost every year. And so, had some questions last year because you paid contribution of you, so you lost the membership for a few months. Okay, before this presentation, also I have three questions. Like, do you have specific staff checking a care system every day?
Yes.
Yes? Yes. Most of you, yes. And what is CSRQ? Customer service require responsibility. What is that? And how does it consist of? And what is your next problem? And why? Please, see that. Okay, first of all, customer service performance. And this is the award standard. I made it very simple, in a very simple way, because still remember on the last, first day, when we try to explain the EMS standard, when we talk about the standard, which one, three or four, when we talk about the customer service, I showed you something like the award standard, it's too troublesome, and this is the most simple one. You see, we measure you and your performance, both measure you as replying partner and as requesting partner. So here, let's have a look. As replying partner, we measure four indicators. As requesting partner, we measure three of them. And these three, time to open. First, the level resolution, close cases within 10 working days, same. Here, as requesting partner, as replying partner, and as requesting partner, same. As replying partner, we have one more, long-time reply. Still remember the concept of long-time reply. We mentioned quite a few times for on-time reply, right? We have different kind of inquiries, and we have different level. So for different level, for different inquiry, you have we have different standard for on-time reply. I will show you later ones. So here, on-time reply, we need you to reach to be over. And then it could be higher than 98%. And time to open request, time to open request must be within 3 working hours. This is not absolutely hour, but working hour. What is the difference of hour and working hour?
Working hour means that what we have decided in the operational
life. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Working hours according to what you publish in your operational guide. For example, in Bangladesh, for example, they work, their working hour is from 8 to 4. This is exactly 8 hours, right? So after 4 o'clock p.m., if an inquiry entered into the system, we did not calculate. We calculate the time starting from next morning from 8 o'clock. So even though you receive the inquiry at midnight, we do not calculate. We start the calculus measure from the starting of your next day's starting time. But from the starting time, within 3 working hours, if you could not open, you are late. So this is the concept of working hours, 3 working hours. And the first level resolution, I think I don't need to spend too much time. That's one round of question and answer. And the problem solved. The case can be closed within the first round. Maybe one question, one reply, or maybe plus several message updates. But no more escalation. So we encourage all of you to be more than 33% of your total cases could be finalized, could be closed within the first level. We call first level resolution. And the closed cases within 10 equals only 15 working days. And now from the beginning of this year, it changed to like 10 working days. And also this percentage used to be 90, and now 92. Because we roughly calculated most of the vendor operators and we found, even if we set the standard higher like this, still we have a lot of operators really could reach the standard, because we are very happy to see that the more and more operators are quite, they quite mind this performance. Not something like at the beginning, for some of the operators, regional coordinators suffered a lot. You know, we have to send a lot of reminders to, hey, please check your ICANN system, you have pending inquiry. For quite a few days, you have not opened, blah, blah. We always do that. And now I did almost nothing about it. Because in Asia Pacific, we seldom, very seldom, we still have pending inquiry. No way. But in some other regions, maybe. So now, sometimes what I received is something like from some of you telling me, hey, Jeff, another country, another region, they do not reply. They have a pending, they receive your inquiry, they did not give you reply. So sometimes most of the complaints I receive is something like this. So I have to find my colleagues in charge of other region. Please push your people to now this is, I'm not saying it's good, but I myself, I feel quite all right, because the Asian Pacific people, we are quite alert people. We are never too slow. So this is the award standard. And let's have a look at the customer service reply responsibility. This is one of the 5 main targets for the award standard, one of the 5. So it consists of on-time reply, which accounts for 50%. First level resolution consists of accounts for 25%, and most cases within 10 working days accounts for another 25%. So we put them all together, it's 100%. So every month, for the monthly report, you will see, you check from the smart. For this indicator, CSRQ, it is composed by these 3 indicators. This is a page number. This is the S-rate flying partner only. Because we stressed this a bit more. This is one of the award standard, main guys. Okay? And this is the on-time reply, and this, I think this should be so time for me to show this, the recent days. You see, we have different inquiries, and we have different level. For different level, for different inquiries, we have different on-time reply standard. Some of them could be one day, some of them could be 3 or even 5 days. We have different standard, but on-time reply is quite or very important. And this is your situation. Hey, last night I had Malay and Cambodia. Hey. Okay, so just have a look. The first one is CSRQ, that's Customer Service Responsibility. So this indicator is composed by on-time reply, 50%, first level resolution, 50%, 25% score from here, most cases. So when you see this report, you can easily know that I'm so happy, you know, to see all of you, so many green color here. Because all these green colors, it means you will reach the standard. Yeah, you reached the award standard, the lowest standard for version levels, 1983. You are over 93, you reached the standard, and it means you must be quite good for on-time reply. For first level resolution or for close cases within 10 working days. And also, we have a time to open. This is also a long lasting problem for me. Because every month, I'm sending regular monthly reports to all of you. And in my memory, the performance, the overall regional performance on time to open, this time to open request and the time to open replies received. For these two indicators, that has been my problem, because I can always find some of you spend too long time on this. It used to be, I mean, for example, in last year, some of you may spend more than 100 hours or even 60 hours or 70 hours because you totally forgot to order. But now, the worst could be 20 hours or 10 hours or something like that. And in May, none of us is over 7 hours. The higher the worst from the operator cost 7 hours, so which is much better than before. But let's have a look here. For time to open request, you have only one inquiry, so that could be the reason you spend a bit long. When you saw it, it's already over 3 hours. Maybe this is the problem for very few inquiry. And another one, very good. And we go, okay. Within 3 hours, it's almost 3 hours. You got here to receive the time to open the replies. You see, 17 hours. This is too long. And this is your own question. non-existing question. And another one is Beijing. It's another 4 hours. So you have only three. You received only three replies. And so you're not checking maybe every day. So maybe it was late. And that's why I suggest, I strongly suggest you to configure one email, reminding email in your system so that whenever you receive the reply or you receive the inquiry, you can see, check it from your email. You can receive a reminding email so that possibly, or in most cases, you will not be late. And what about the name here? Another one is Mongolia. 3 hours and it's almost 4 hours. You have totally nine replies, which is not very few, but you also, I remember you have a lady who is specially in charge of the meetings. But she sometimes joined in my online meeting. Mongolia is a characteristic is not so stable, sometimes can be very good, and sometimes a drop a little. And for personal level resolution, usually I do not complain too much. For closed cases within 10 working days, I also usually I do not push it, because I think this is it is more realistic. Maybe you have only case, and maybe in this case you have big trouble with your partner. You may need really need more time, or several explanation maybe you need. So I never complain. But this is something we definitely we should control. We could control the time to open here. And another one is on-time reply. We should be able to control by ourselves. You should be able to give the reply within the limited time. So, generally speaking here, we can find that according to for the numbers of cases or inquiries, some country has a lot more, like China, obviously more, and Indonesia, obviously quite a lot, and then Myanmar and the Vietnam also has more inquiries and more cases. But for some of you, when you have really one, just one or two cases, one or two inquiries, it's really easy for you to make a mistake, to miss, to be late. So, suggested action plans. Many operators with very few inquiries or requests should check the system at least 4 times a day. Why 4 times a day? If you can make sure to check your system 4 times a day, you can make sure that everything could not be missed, could not be over 3 hours. And you can set a kind of a time, like for example, if you start to work from 8 o'clock, so 8 o'clock you check once, or 9 o'clock you check for the first time, and 2 hours later, or 2.5 hours later, second time, another 2 hours, third time, in that case you can make sure that you will not spend more than 3 working hours to open. And the second one, operators with very few inquiries or requests should provide 3 validated emails. This is what I mentioned in the morning. In ACAD call center configuration, and check reminding emails regularly. And operators with more cases, you may check pending inquiries or replies regularly and every day. Because it's easy for the more inquiry countries to have pending one. The pending not only could happen by yourself, but also sometimes also pending in your destination, in your partner side. So if you find a lot of pending in your partner side, you can also let me know so that I can help you to push the other partner over process. Otherwise, because this performance, I think you can easily find that because we are measuring you not only as replying, but also as requesting. So if your partner is not good enough, your performance also will be badly influenced, and you cannot be good. So it is very important to monitor, to improve not only yourself, and also monitor or push your partner. And this one, message update could not replace reply. This happened once in which country, in one of the islands country. Because I found one pending inquiry, and for quite a long time, the operator did not reply. When I tracked that case, I found they did not reply. And so I followed the operator, asked them why not reply. They say, we replied. We updated the message already, quite long before. So later I carefully checked the case and I found that as replying partner, this operator did not provide a reply. Instead, they directly provide a message, an update message directly. For the first reply, you should provide a reply first. Right? This is one wrong. You ask me, I reply. No, they did not reply. They gave the partner a direct updated message instead of a reply. So they never gave a reply. But they thought, we replied, we updated the message for them. So later I found the question is like, they never replied, they directly gave an updated message. This is wrong. So that's why here, as I say, the message update could not replace reply. After you reply, if you have more information you would like to tell the other side, you can send updated message. In that case, this case is still not escalated, still in level one, but you provided more information. This is very good. But it should be after you give a reply first. Okay, and the last suggestion is close the cases manually if you feel the reply is okay for your customers. As usually, as requesting partner, you have the right to close this case. So the case could be closed in two different ways. It can be closed manually, or it will be closed automatically. Automatically means if the case ended, there's no more escalation, no more other message. After that, 1 month. 1 month after that, the case, if there's no more update, the case will be automatically closed. And the performance will not be influenced. The calculation is on maybe 1 month later, but other things, all your performance will not be influenced. And another way is that as requesting partner, if you send the inquiry, you receive the reply, you feel everything is alright, you can manually close this case. In that case, you can have, you know, less numbers in the ICAS system, so that you see who's doing so many things in this and there. And this is what Vietnam Post is doing. And they are not manually close their own case. They also push the partner to close the case. And when they feel, when they reply some case, they feel, I have given you quite satisfied the reply, and you did not send me any more questions, but you still do not order close. I remind you, hey, you can close it. this is maybe too much, but I mean, they really kept very good points. They make the partners always very alert. Okay, so finally, questions. Do you have a specific stuff checking application? I don't need to ask you too long, because some of you yes, some of you no. And also, I know in many countries, you have a call center, it's a concentrated call center, not only for international, but also for domestic. Not only for EMS, but also for parcel packing, everything, right? I saw quite a few different call centers, and in some country, I saw very beautiful call center and beautiful girls sitting inside and make the calling. And also, I saw some very terrible atmosphere in the office. Now we are a group of people, you know, sweating all over, too busy. And I mean, the people is never enough. I still remember when I saw in Philippines call center, a group of girls are so busy. They are well speaking. The telephone ring the bell, and I always engage. And they have limited staff, obviously. And the last time when I saw in India, in Delhi, a call center is quite good. The call center is room, but only three receptions, three seats could process again. Yes, I saw three seats, two staff. But the situation in India is that they have 8 call centers, different call centers, and that is only in Delhi. They told me they are planning to make all the ICAS function concentrated in Delhi instead of all other call centers, which is too complicated. And finally, the pending, I have to remind Honda again. Maybe I'm sorry to say that I have sent you the cases has still not been opened. You need to open process. Otherwise, in our region, there is only one pending inquiry for quite a long time. And okay, what is your main problem? Any main problem for ICAS? Operation? Any? No? Not have. And also, I would like to say special thanks for not only the award winner, but also Bangladesh. Because quite a few years ago, I had a review in Bangladesh Post. I spent 1 week there, and at that time, the customer service I saw was 2 seats, 1 man. And if he goes out to have a pee, or if he goes out to for a lunch, nobody there. Nobody stay there. So nobody could pick got the phone call or the nobody to check the inquiry, blah blah. And the atmosphere is very, very, very bad. And in recent years, I found that the Bangladesh Post improved steadily, and until now you are almost a lot better. And I'm very happy last year. In last year's EMS workshop in Tokyo, I made a presentation on behalf of the Bangladesh Post to introduce some good experience they achieved on the aspect of customer service, customer care. So we have some people, originally not so good, but now pretty good. And I also would like to see more people or more countries could achieve in the award standard. And telling you the truth, in recent years, or in the past few years, every year, for the customer care award winners all over the world, globally, usually, in the past, usually, Asia Pacific accounts for half of the total. For example, if we have to calculate about 20 award winners, at least 10 from Asia Pacific. And now, one third. You know why? That's my colleague Hamadou. He is in charge of Africa and Arab. And you can find more operators from Africa and from Arab countries. It's so good now. So I also hope that we will have more and more winners. This is not only a kind of just award. It shows that your strength and your determination to improve yourself. Okay, and this is okay. I don't know who designed this. It looks funny. You care, I care, we care. System introduction. I think I have done it this morning, but for the last few pages, I would like to show you. These are the main functions for the healthcare system. Here this one, the different users, I would like to repeat. We have three different kinds of users. We have call center managers. They have a complete right. You can not only receive, but also send, but also configure the system. But for agent, you can only receive and process the inquiries, but you cannot configure the system. And for operational users, you can only track. And you cannot process. So I myself strongly, as time goes by, I strongly suggest that you may have more call center managers in each of your operator, especially people like you guys, and you yourself could change yourself if you are not a manager. Change yourself as a manager because you can have a bigger power, more rights to configure, to make everything. We do not have any limit for any call center. You have only one manager, two manager, you can have more managers, and so that you can have more people, especially people in charge of operation, better to have more, a role like a manager. This is one. The other one is for work for motivation. This one I have mentioned this morning for the system configuration. You have complete information here. Usually, and now complete the configuration also here. And holidays uploaded from the operational guide is all right. Over here, I strongly suggest you to make complete the 3 emails for different kind of inquiries, reminders, to receive the reminders. And this is the performance report I showed you just now for each call center. If you check the report part, you have 2 parts of the report, as replying partner and as requesting partner. And this is system configuration, 5 working days per week, with 2 days as holidays in each week. And 8 working hours per day. You can start from 8 to 4, 8:30 to 30, 9 to 5, up to you. And provide 3 emails for this 3 different kind of information. And update public holidays, not in directly in ICANN, but in EMS operational guide. And what I want to show you is something like this. And these operators of you, Fiji, Haiti, Lanka, Maldives, Nauru, Vietnam, you have 2 call centers, one in Hanoi, the other one in Ho Chi Minh City. And this is for Ho Chi Minh City call center. You do not have the email configuration, but I don't worry about you because you're always pushing others. Vietnamese, always pushing others instead of being pushed. So if you configure now, I don't mind. You can see your performance is pretty good. And Samoa. Especially in this list, especially if you have a very limited inquiry, better configure the system. And missing 2 emails, Laos, Mongolia, Nepal, Papua, and Tonga, and Hanoi is okay. And missing 1 email, and China, I don't worry about you, because these 2 countries always quite good. So these are the questions. Okay, they are too easy to see now. Are you tired? What about the chocolate? Already finished? Tomorrow I will bring something more. Okay, are you feel exhausted?
It's just okay.
Tired. Okay, if you are really tired, you can stand up or you can go out and take a cup of tea or whatever. So I will just keep going. Next item. This is, it seems quite complicated, but actually quite simple. It's quite simple. You can save a lot of time for you. And so to start with this presentation, I would also like you to pay a bit more attention on the questions. First one. EMS PLP is on the basis of which 2 indicators? Which?
deliver rate?
Nobody?
How I deliver? How to deliver rate?
I repeated it several times, I think in these days.
On time delivery.
Based on which two indicators? That's right. Thank you. On time delivery plus on time transmission of which? Of the first delivery scan. Okay. And what are the common penalty and the threshold for EMS PLP now? Panel common penalty now is always something like 80%, which means that no matter how bad you are, you can get at least 80% of the total penalty. And the threshold is a target for on-time delivery plus on-time transmission. Usually we set the target at 95%. And the PLP report, the item weight information comes from the EMD or EMC or from which scan? From which scan? From D? From C? The weight information?
EMC.
From EMC.
And what are the main privileges of signing multilateral PLP agreement? Some of you sign, come on, some of you sign a multilateral. What is the privilege? Like Bhutan, like Cambodia, like Indonesia, and Malawi,
like and
Mongolia. What is the first one? And Papua also signed, and Samoa signed, Vietnam signed, and some other countries. I have some target countries like Japan, Thailand, Sri Lanka. I just had a talk with Mr. Navarro. I talked with him. It's high time because I followed him for 3 years and he told me, oh, you are considering that. But up to now, not yet. So, let's start. Background of PRP. PFP is a kind of an agreement. Agreement. It's argument that's not also not a mistake. Sometimes you argue. It's an agreement between EMS operators and to use an accounting system, leads payment for delivery of EMS item to the quality of service provided, which means the better performance you provided, the higher
rate you will get.
Payment you receive. The worse performance you, the worse service you perform, the less payment you get. It's very easy. And history of PRP. You can see that in 2002, first the PRP agreement was implemented. 2009, PRP became mandatory for EMS barcode numbers. And from 2011, PRP multilateral agreement introduced. At the beginning, it is all bilateral. You and I just in pairs to sign this PRP, to pay each other, to measure each other. Later, from 2011, multilateral agreement introduced. And then from 2016, EMS EVT3 is mandatory for PRP. For PRP, we started to use V3 instead of V1. Because in V3, for example, the time in customs should be deducted for on-time delivery measurement, right? And in V1, what is the time in customs? Still remember? In V1, time in customs starts from which one? You still remember. Okay, you are too young.
Yes.
You are too young. Yes. And you still, you could conduct, you could not know 7 years ago. The time in customs calculated from EME to EMF. Still remember, from E to F. That time is calculated as the time in customs. But for B3, the time in customs must be from EDB to EDC. We have specific scans to calculate the time in customs. And I myself started working in EMS unit from 2012. So I witnessed the later development, and on 2018, on time delivery based only on EMS unit with B3, which means from 2018, we truly calculated the timing different timing customs by using EDB and EDC. And then by the end of 2021, we are using two post style reports, because in the old PRP reports, we are identifying all the items as document and metadata. And in the new reports, we are using weight rankings reports, 0 to 2, 2 to 5, 5 to 10, 10 to 30, four different weight brackets. We made everything like this in the new PLP report. And the benefit, I don't need to say too much, is pay according to the service you get, and the single accounting, because we have two kinds of report. One is monthly report. The other one is a quarterly report. The quarterly, the last page of the quarterly report can be directly used for accounting. If you put in related data, then everything automatically calculated, and you can make the accounting with your partner on the basis of that, which save a lot of time. Okay, how does PRP work? Now, it comes. PRP worked by setting a performance target for on-time delivery and on-time translation of first delivery scan. And the performance target is referred as the performance threshold. The threshold now is 95, which means your performance of on-time delivery plus on-time transmission must be over 95. If not, you get reduced payment. And on-time delivery is measured against the validated delivery standard. You know that for each of you, you have finalized the 3 legs standard, leg 1, leg 2, and leg 3, and this is the leg 3 standard. We measure you according to the delivery standard to see if you are on-time delivered or not. And the transmission is measured according to the rule agreed by EMS market members, which means within 5 hours. In this year, it is 5 hours on-time transmission. And in next year, it will be 4. And next year, it will be 3. So, close. without constantly just adjusting. The first delivery scan should be transmitted within 5 hours of the event having taken place. This is on-time transmission. And the payment is based on quarterly report and all accounting based on electronic data. And if your partner do not provide the service as promised, you put less, or you pay less for the delivery. And on the contrary, it's the same. If we ourselves could not provide a good on-time delivery performance, we also suffer a lot. We get also reduced payment. Accounting based on electronic data of the weight information from one team. So now you know in PFP report, as you know, we have the weight information. And all those weight information for items, first of all, comes from EMD. That is why we always stress that when you receive the item or when you make the D-scan, you need to wait. Do you do that? All of you? You need to wait the inbound items one by one or pack by pack. You see, if the actual weight is same as they mark what they mark in the bag label. If they say 25 kg or 25 kg, maybe you need to measure the degree weight. Do you do all of you do that?
Yes.
When you open the mail bag, or before the mail bag, you wait. Or item by item, you read, check, make sure if the item is same as what it is marked for the item information or for the back label information. So this information, first of all, comes from D-scan. Okay, and then if the D-scan could not provide this information, it comes from C-scan. Comes from your origin post information. If D-scan and the C-scan, both D-scan and C-scan could not provide any weight information, and then this item's weight will be calculated as the maximum weight granted. It belongs to one, it will be calculated as the one of the items in between 10 to 30, it's the highest automatically. That is why we always suggest stressing that you should make complete scan, and for each scan, complete the data element. For example, when you make a C scan, weight information is one of the most important data elements in C scan. And from the beginning of this year, for the N40 compliance, for D-scan, we also need you to have complete weight information. In that case, we can automatically take the weight information from D-scan, from the weight you checked or you confirmed yourself. This is more reasonable, right? But if you give up this right, it's not so good. And when your partner do not provide service to promise you, they have you pay less. And this is very important. In case of no weight information in C, no weight in D comes from C. If you could not find the information from C, the weight will be calculated as the highest. Awesome. And this is the basic methodology for the payment by PFP. Okay, now let's have a look. This is the rule of this year. The threshold is 95%. The penalty is 80%. Okay, and if your performance of on-time delivery plus on-time transmission is 97%, then you get how many payment? 100%, right? Because this is over the threshold. For any score over the threshold, you get full payment, which means if your performance of on-time delivery plus on-time transmission is 95, 96, 97, 98, or 99, you get 100% payment. You get full payment. And what about 92? If your performance of on-time delivery plus on-time transmission is only 92, so how much, how many payment, how much payment you should get? So this is 3 points lower than 95, right? So also 3 points lower than 100. So if you are achieve a performance like this, like 92, you may get 97% of the total payment, of the full payment. Okay, another example. 70. If your on-time delivery and on-time transmission achieve only 70, how much you should get? 70, you see, 95 minus 70, that's 25, right? So 100 minus 25, it should be 75. Here should be 75. But you get 80% because we have a kind of a so-called penalty, which guarantee at least how much you can get. So no matter how, even if you are very bad, you can at least get 80% of the total of the full payment. This is a simple methodology to, you simply can know that roughly how they calculate the payment. And delivery rate of those published in operational guide as you did every year by yourself. And I don't know how many of you made or updated your delivery rate. You cannot make it by yourself, of course. For delivery rate update, you need to send a message email to my colleague, Vanessa, and she make it for you. But every year, if you would like to adjust your delivery rate, you know what you do? Any of you do that? According to the rules of procedure, every year, each operator has one opportunity to adjust the delivery rate. But if you would like to adjust the delivery rate of the next year, you need to give us the request from our application by the end of August of this year.
August.
This is a rule according to the rules of procedure, which means if any of you would like to update your next year's delivery rate for the year of 2024, then in 2023, before the end of the August, anytime before that time, you must hand in your application by email, by letter, by whatever methodology. Anyway, you have to inform the EMS unit so that we can help you to publish the next year's delivery rate by the end of August. While we also do something, because we have a kind of a, how to say that, a basic judgment to see if your delivery rate is too high or not very high. Because I basically know that in my mind, some of your delivery rate still kept quite low level, which is quite competitive. But some of us already put up our delivery rate higher and higher year by year, quite high. And most of the European countries, they set their delivery rate much higher than our region. Of course, they have some reason, like they are developing countries and their labor cost is much higher than ours. But now in EMS unit, together with the EMS board members, especially the present 9 board members, they are constantly in their mind, trying their best to control the delivery rate adjustment. Because originally, we have no room. Like, if you say, hey, Bhutan would like to put up our, adjust our delivery rate from this year, for example, per item 10 SDR, and we would like to put it at 20 SDR next year. Can we approve? So we have another responsibility to, we call challenge. So from time to time, regional coordinators, poor regional coordinators, I have no right to stop you, but I have some right to challenge you. I would send an email to your boss or to you, maybe trying to persuade, hey, your labor cost is that high, or your original price is that here, and then you really want to put it like this, or your delivery performance, or your performance is not that good, do you really want to make that your delivery rate that high? So we have some reasons to challenge you. But in most cases, this challenge maybe did not work, but I still need to challenge. But now we are, I have to say, now we are trying to develop some basic rules, like if you would like to adjust or put up your delivery rate in the coming years, you must reach some standard. For example, your delivery performance must be over blah blah, or your complete measurement rate should be over a certain degree, or should be, or you must achieve optimal volume growth. So I mean, we are trying to add some necessary conditions to try to control the trend of delivery rate is getting higher and higher, which cannot be controlled. And so another symptom is that we saw so many operators complaining about partners delivery rate, while you yourself also did yourself getting higher. So this is something very bad for the further development of the EMS. I talked too much. Okay, and the PRP changes in 2022. The main change, you see, EMS cooperative members agreed in business plan to set competitive selling price for low weight items. And this is the origin, thought. Why we would like to adjust why we like to promote the weight branches instead of a document and recognize. Why? And in EMS, sorry. The EMS RFQ for GA 2020 members agreed to form a working group to study on the weighted weight brackets because this weighted brackets concept was raised from different regions, I remember, symposiums. And I myself also experienced at least twice Asia-Pacific EMS symposium. And in the symposium, some countries suggested, or strongly suggested, that we should, EMS should make, should achieve a better, better development for cross-border e-commerce. And if we would like to achieve better, we need to set a very competitive price for the smaller packs for cross-border e-commerce. According to our present delivery rate structure, it is not, the price is not favorable. So later we strongly suggested that we change this system has four different brackets, especially for the weight brackets for 0 to 2. For these weight brackets, we are aiming at the cross-border e-commerce, and we are aiming to set a kind of a universal or similar, a favorable, a more reasonable price for items from 0 to 2. We tried to do that, but so far we could not, still could not succeed, but we are trying to go on that target, for that target. So members agreed by ballot later in 2020, no longer support accounting for document and rules, but to rather support accounting based on weight brackets. This is approved by ballot, by voting from all of you. This is one of the privileges for EMS RFQ, because as you know, if you would like to change this for parcel, you can try. Maybe several, quite a few years, maybe you can never do it. But for EMS, after we send a number, we approve, we can adjust. Their situation is totally different. So in China, we have a saying, the bottom beside your hand, which means where you sit beside what you think about. We had a lot of arguments actually. But at the beginning, I should say, the target, the aim is very ideal. When student Jim was still here, we tried to dream, you know, we had a very good dream. And we used to aim at 0 to 2 as a universal price all over the world so that nobody could put up freely the price, and so that we can greatly encourage the cross-border e-commerce volume. And actually, when we really talking about that, the US, France, Netherlands will say we are developing countries and our labor cost is much higher. So, 5 hours here, no, we have to put it much higher. And Japan, the when they say, maybe okay, maybe not, but China will say, no.
Japan is always the common sense.
So they have different negotiations, I heard. Some people suggest that we have three different levels. But anyway, this trip has not been ended yet. But we may still achieve something. So, EMS operators may either set a single capacity or a rate for the rate practice. We are encouraging you to do this. And I'm so surprised to see that in our region, we still have some countries using single rate, which is very old. Because in the last few years, in the past few years, more and more countries are starting using per item, per kilo system. One item for one piece, how much? And for each kilometer or kilogram, how much? More and more countries started using that system. And now we are encouraging you, if you are using that system, we are encouraging you to use this one. You can roughly identify or divide all your items in two different brackets, and you can set four different price for 0 to 2, 2 to 5, 5 to 10, and 10 to 30. And in that case, I think we can greatly or better control, especially this one, not to be too high. If you set a price like a per item and per kilo, then for 30 kilo, it could be very high. It could be 60 or 50 or 60 SDR, which is but if you set a rate for four brackets, weight brackets, usually we can control the especially the heavier items delivery, not too high. And the PFP change in 2020 means accounting document has been updated to handle great weight structures and both missions. In the second half of 2018, we are sending two different kinds of reports. One is identified by document recognized, the other one for four different brackets, and from 2022, all PRP reports are in weight brackets. After the coffee break, I will show you the present report. And this is a kind of an example for the present PMP report. And you see orange for A, identified by document rules and goods for inbound and outbound each partner. And now we have that the new report is like this. For inbound, we look for weight blankets. For outbound, also for different weight blankets. This is maybe more scientific or more specific. And in the new PRP report, we have different pages. For different pages, we have a table, different tables. We have table 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, 1E, 1F, 1G. And to show the inbound, outbound, to show the inbound volume and outbound volume in different weight brackets. And for flat file, you can download from Smart. All these can be downloaded from Smart. If you would like to find the more specific data for cross weight, information from C scan, from D scan, and the weight category. I have, now we have even in EMS Smart, we can easily find this weight information for all the items. And the weight category, discrepancy, and destination control. I mean, all this information could be found. And also, this is the report example showing here. You see the partner operator. This is the weight brackets. This is the items with D and with the EMSD and no delivery. With D and EDX, which means this item you receive and then terminated, return back. You can receive full payment for delivery. And then item deliver in the current period. And this should be, receive payment, right? And the missing EMP, total accounts payable items, and on-time delivery plus on-time transmission. The later demand, this is on-time, this is items reach the standard, and these are the items that did not reach the standard, and the different situation why they did not reach the standard. It's a clear identification so that you can see one by one which items reach the standard totally, and those which items did not reach the standard and why or where they failed. You can check the general situation from this table. Also, you can easily find everything from Smart. And from Smart, you can check everything like this, and then you can easily find or download that file for each part. So, if you would like, you can also check from EMS website. This is the website. And you can find the explanation documents to show the PRP. And also, if you try to check from YouTube, you have access to YouTube, right?
Yes.
If you check YouTube, if you check PRP in YouTube, in most cases, you also can find some small movies introducing basically the PRP methodology or PRP ideas or something, quite a few small movies in YouTube, so you can find. And this is a very important weight-based pay for performance FAQs. It's frequently asked questions. And in the website, you can easily find this. And I myself found, I read this quite a few times, and every time I ask, okay, the new weight bracket concept is like this, and it has some privilege or something. So they provide you quite good explanations about PRP, about the change of weight brackets. Okay, last part, multilateral PRP. In 2012, I have to take you will have all the presentations, there's no problem. From 2012, I started to work in the EMS unit, I tried hard to persuade or to push my operators of you to sign both multilateral PRP and bilateral PRP. And also, I spent quite a long time, a lot of time on calculating who will be good partners to sign bilateral to raise the total PRP rate Later, after 2 or 3 years, later, I realized that the bilateral PRP is good, but
not so good.
Too slow. The multilateral PRP is a much better way. So later, I seldom encourage any country or any operator to consider bilateral. Because it cost a lot of time and the total rate did not change a lot. So what I did is encourage more and more people to consider multilateral. In that case, save a lot of time. And immediately you will reach a world standard for PRP. And this is the multilateral PRP signatory situation all over the world. And now together, we have altogether 92. Actually, 91 or 92, but one or two already left the EMS group. We signed multilateral earlier years, and because they failed to pay the contribution. You know, in recent years, some countries lost membership. So now, altogether, we have only 173 or 175. We used to have 190 member operators, but now 170 something. So the signatories for multilateral PRP also reduced to 90. And among these 90 signatories, well, this is something I confirmed before I came. Europe, 30 from Europe, 9 from Caribbean, 20 from Africa, and 5 from Arab. This is not so easy, you know. In Africa, they have more countries, like maybe 50, about 50 countries. 20 maybe not so high, but you have to be alert that you have to be knowing that traditionally, in most of African countries, their performance is not that good. So if they sign multilateral, they are losing. They get less payment. But it shows a kind of maybe determination for more and more African countries. They would like to
improve it.
Yeah, they would like to prove themselves. You know what I have to say. Okay, for Asia Pacific, we have 22 operators already signed this multilateral PRP, and who are us? These are the number change of numbers for multilateral PRP year by year, from 2011 on 8 until last year 19, and you see very small change in recent 3 years, because during the pandemic, no matter how hard we try, not so many people would like to consider this. So this is the least important, not as important as transport issues. And this is the situation in Asia Pacific. You see, in our region, Mongolia signed the first multilateral PRP at the beginning of the year, and then Samoa, and then Solomon Island, and then Kiribati and Vanuatu. You see, except for Mongolia, all other earlier signatories are all Pacific Islands countries. Why? Island countries, you know why?
Multilateral agreement involves 2 countries.
Okay, you have something there. Because I also did some work, you know. I have to say that because when I started to work as a regional coordinator, I found for those Pacific Islands countries, they can never reach the standard of PRP because their biggest partner is Australia. And Australia refused to sign any bilateral PRP. So these countries cannot sign with Australia, and Australia is the biggest partner. The biggest partner refused to sign. What should be done? So no matter how hard they try, even though they sign all with all other partners, their PIP rate is still something like 5% or 10%. It's far from 40% at that time. Or later it increased to 50, and now almost 90. If you reach 90%, you reach the world standard. So later, I complained about it. So later the measurement team and they launched a ballot, and then after voting, the EMS committee finally agreed that if you sign the multilateral, you pass the gate. If you sign the multilateral agreement, you are qualified for award. Otherwise, they can never be qualified. This is a kind of story happened quite a few years ago. So at the beginning, my focus is is on the island's countries and encourage them to sign. And then you're okay. And also they have regulated model, and it's quite easy for them to control their performance quality. And then later it became harder and harder because more and more Asian countries started considering this. You see it from 2015, Bhutan and Iran, two Asian countries. And 2016, you see Cambodia, Malaysia. This is now, these are now Pacific Islands countries. And in 2017, Singapore, Indonesia, Korea. And then Myanmar, Hong Kong. And then Macau, Vietnam, and French Polynesia. And after, unfortunately, late after 2019, nobody would like to sign this multilateral anymore because maybe the shortage of transport, lacking of transport, maybe occupies all your mind. So now, here, I would like to encourage you to think about are those countries who has not yet signed multilateral PRP, you may consider the advantage of multilateral PRP, which is save a lot of time and commit it more and reach a world standard immediately. And this is the situation of June this year for each of you. The situation of PRP and the situation of on-time delivery plus on-time transmission of the first delivery scan. I tracked this from the smart. You see, let's see one by one. Bangladesh, you have not signed any PRP.
Yes.
No bilateral, no multilateral. But you still have some problem for on-time delivery. But your on-time transmission is pretty good. And your on-time delivery mainly comes from late delivery. If you can improve some late delivery, you are pretty good. And for Brunei, zero. Because you made some mistakes. I think for auto sequence, auto or something. And zero is the PRP, and 62, because you still have some problem for out of sequence. And for on-time transmission, it's also not so good, same problem. And Bhutan, I don't know what happened. Okay, it's quite good for on-time delivery and on-time transmission. And China has bilateral. But did not sign the multilateral. I really want to encourage China, but you see your on-time delivery, 72. And you told me it's much better than before. Now it's far from better. And you have to consider, I mean, on the last day we will talk about this. You have to consider the redesign of the total uniform scans, especially in PD and EDC scans. We did not sign multilateral, so your ability is very low. And but your performance is also, you also have some problems. From Indonesia, you signed a multilateral, but you have some problem in June. What happened? You don't know. You should know. You have some not so stable data transmission. And China also happened, big problem. Never happened before, but might happen in June for 2 or 3 days, no data transmission. And later, all the data transmitted, but late transmission is very serious. And China's on-time transmission, all the time, if you check, always over 99%. But in June, it was a big mistake, a big problem. For Cambodia, absolutely. Wow. You have some problem for late delivery here. And along, I think you may consider a multilateral right now. And for Lanka, you see, not so bad. And if you can achieve this a bit, and your performance for on-time delivery is not always on 90, in most cases higher. That's why I made a call to knowledge to persuade him it's high time. What are you thinking about? And Mongolia, you have some question for on-time delivery. Maldives, almost excellent. And for Nepal, you have some questions. And also from Nepal, you have also other questions like delivery, like standard revalidation. You need to revalidate the leg 1, leg 2, and the leg 3. Because in both in 3 legs, you have a lot of anomaly and some OE codes, some destination, or some postal codes are not included. You are using, but not included. So we will come to that later. For the ball problem, I have another problem. Now I got you. And I sent a lot of emails to different contact people, but very few. Very occasionally, I can get a reply. It seems that nobody can give me a reply. And now, you have a kind of email that's an EMS at Nepal Post or something. And another contact is the GPO master. And another one. I have quite a few contacts, but seldom give me a quick reply. So we can, at least you can guarantee a quick reply from me, right? Okay, Nauru, Mr. Nauru. You did not have any performance in June because you did not deliver. So you did not have any score. But I checked your earlier results when your delivery. Your delivery performance is 100% good. You have no problem. 100% good for both delivery and on-time delivery and on-time transmission. But, and also one of your, maybe your CEO, or maybe your Australian advisor,
Chris.
Also Chris. Both of them once asked me about the possibility of signing this multilateral ARP because I suggested several times and they say they would like to do that, but up to now, nothing. Nothing has been done, so maybe you may consider this one. And Papua already signed, Tonga already signed, Tonga's performance is pretty good, and Vietnam, excellent. and Samoa used to be very good, but I don't know what happened in June. It's not so good, but in most cases, your performance, the culture is not so stable. Sometimes very good, super, and sometimes because of one or two items, yeah, also limited. You have to be very careful. If you feel on one or two, you feel a lot. Okay, this is a kind of suggestion. So the focus on on-time delivery should be these operators, and the focus on both should be these operators. You have questions? Okay, what are the main advantages of signing multilateral ERP? And any of you would like to consider or reconsider this multilateral ERP after this training? Okay, I think it's high time for coffee break. Sorry for 10 minutes late.